panel, and their very distinguished bios are in your booklet. So please take a look to see the star-studded panel that we have assembled here. I just want to say, and I spoke in the morning, so I'm going to be brief, that this panel is the closest to my heart, and at some point we're even thinking of making the theme of this panel the theme of the entire conference, because it's a very critical issue where Islamic thought is there today and the importance of coming up with a new narrative to counter the prevailing stories and narratives of hate and violence. So with that, I will hand it over to my dear friend and brother and scholar, Professor Malik.
Thank you very much. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim wa salatu wa salamu ala ashraf al-mursaleen al-Nabi al-Arabi al-Fatih lima ughliq wal-Khatim lima sabaq nasir al-Haqq bil-Haqq wal-Hadi ila siratih al-Mustaqim. I'm very privileged to be invited to this event. I feel one of the main reasons I came, of course, is because it's an important topic, but also it's not every day that you get to engage with dear friends who have been trained in the liberal tradition as well as the Islamic tradition itself. And I have been long an enthusiast of the Abadi school, which we will discuss later on with Sheikh Mohammed. But to begin, I just want to give some context to where we're going, which is about narrative. So every era has its narrative, but in the age-old struggle to police the structures of historical narratives, we find a central commonality, which is the translational interconnection between the idea and the society. The interrelational connectivity can be positive or negative. Historically, we find the al-aql al-arabi, the Arab mind, not engaged with the self. We either find al-aql reactionary towards its surroundings or other experiences. Think of the Greek experience. This reconciliatory phenomena, if you wish, was the prevailing one. So in essence, it leaves us with a dualism between aql and naql, as we know. One is concerned with textual aspects and the other is connected with reason, innovation, which is the topic of what we're talking about in ijtihad. If history deems dualism as a necessity for an intellectual discourse, today, of course, we find ourselves very desperate and in need of a new dualism. First, a dialogue between religion, humanism on the one hand, and knowledge in its wider meaning of progress. We need to understand, develop, and define those areas where knowledge or science can freely move and function, and do the same for the operation of religion in its realm. Second, I add to that my own personal background, which relates to the relationship between religion and freedom. Freedom has become the battleground of ideas, ethnicity, identity, gender, sectarianism, beliefs, and so on. Taken individually, those were themes that have become the obsession and a source of paranoia for those who research Islamic studies around the world. So we mustn't forget that the Hobbesian sort of despotic nature has been rejected a long time ago in our Islamic tradition. And even faith itself, Islam started with freedom, the freedom not to submit. But the dual discourse has been lost on us at such a fundamental ethical level. Think of the ethical grounds that even the Dalai Lama himself sort of is arguing for and advocating for instead of religion itself as a common place for mankind. Freedom and the human experiment include uncontested, self-evident notions about rights and liberties, the freedom that holds strong the rule of law. And in that way, in our way that we seek al-jadda, is a new Arab narrative. an Arab narrative that doesn't look at its past with resentment, with sukht, but looks at the future, embraces a future that is enthusiastic, built on reason, on seriousness, mindful of the importance of intergenerational equity. When we look at the Islamic mind, at its inception, we find custom, al-urf, as a source of law, which means the reasoned interaction between a nas, the text, and reality. We also see it tackling public good, or maslaha, as a legal marker for the interaction between humanism and scripture. Through this, our civilization was blessed with a tapestry of schools of jurisprudence and thought. فتنوعت المذاهب كل بحسب طبيعته. The Hanafi madhab took its shape and form in Iraq. The Maliki features in Medina. The Shafi'i had its iterations in the Hijaz and later consolidated in Egypt and so on, including if you want to think of the Shia tradition, which more recently from the Imami periods through Jabal Amil and the transition to the Safavi Empire and Shah Ismail's interaction with Al-Karaki and Majlisi later on, and the evolution of the Ikhbari and Usuli schools. Closest to my heart, which I'll go back to with Sheikh Muhammad, is the Ibadi Madhab, in especially the last 10 years. And of course, those foundations go back to Jabir ibn Zayd, radallahu anhu, developed, of course, a very unique feature, features and sources. I'm going to talk about that a little bit as I introduce Sheikh Muhammad and give him that the podium or the final say. But before that, I want to start. I would have started with Dr. Sohaira just because ladies must go first. However, both Dr. Ahmad and Dr. Sohaira have this interesting relationship, which is a sheikh with tilmidhu. وطبعاً after a while the sheikh التلميذ يعني يكون it's their own the student forms their own views and then the student revolts against the sheikh. So whether it's Ibn al-Qayyim Ibn Taymiyyah Ibn al-Qayyim or al-Afghani and Ibn Muhammad Abdu, it remains to be untested. But with that, let me start Dr. Ahmad Maulana, which sort of brings us, يعني, 17 years of having a little council at Harvard for discussing special fatwa, including what should students do with some specific social issues. We hold dear this memory of an ideal time, a golden age, so idealized, so revered, that history has sort of represented it and represented it in so many iterations. We think of Wathiqat al-Madina, we think of al-Sahaba, the only Islamic state that I believe was there during the Prophet's time, al-Khulafa, and so on. And then we zoom through history with all of the changes that occurred, and somehow we pretend that it's been ideal forever. And the only reference is what we know back then. If we were to talk about statehood, structure, institution, political thought, and specifically political Islam, as the minister said this morning. Can you give us a thunder view of what you think or where you think things stand, and just give us a description, since he actually put the burden on the academics. And bismillah.
Very good. So we're talking about law first, although there's a larger topic, which is Islamic ways of thinking. Islamic law is a significant element of national laws in the Arab world. It's also a significant element of national laws outside of the Arab world in areas that are neighbors of the Arab world, the Muslim world. Now, being part of the national law, that means it's part of the legacy of Muslims and non-Muslims who live among Muslims. And I'm talking about areas where the traditions have been very strong for a long time. Now, Islamic law also is the foundation of many personal laws, laws that people impose on themselves in areas like bioethics, in questions about life and death, for example, from reproductive technology and the rental of wombs to euthanasia and other issues. Now, in these areas, the national law has to either accommodate the individual or be silent, not say anything about it. So in some cases, the national law says nothing, and then the individual can actually create these commitments on himself or his family, or her family. And in some cases, the national law says, I'll accommodate you because I have a commitment. Like in the United States, through some constitutional commitments in the federal law, federal law is much more important. The Civil Rights Act, for example, 1965, prohibits discrimination on religion, which means that Arabs and Muslims living in the United States can live by aspects of this personal law. Islamic law also is part of a new kind of law, the transnational law. Islamic finance is one element of it. With all its problems, we acknowledge it. And this new cyber jurisprudence, the law without a community, very new phenomenon, globalized communities. You can find questions and answers, and for the first time in our Islamic legal history, we don't have the context. The urf is not part of the question. That's new, and it needs a lot of caution, of course. But now, aggregated together, of course, you can't hide it under the rug. There isn't a big rug for that. And B, you should begin to observe it, right? I recognize this audience probably never even thought about hiding it, but there are other audiences that are part of our communities, that are part of the Arab world or the Muslim world that we're part of, who would rather not see this thing at all. And there are also the people who romanticize it, that Malik mentioned. Some of the people who romanticize it are not Muslim, for example. There's a scholar, Palestinian Christian scholar, significant individual, one of the best legal historians we've had in American universities, who loves the Sharia so much he thinks it's too good for modernity. So my starting point is, no, don't romanticize it, accept it, and observe it. And notice, for example, that in the last 150 to 200 years, each one of these nations, now we talk about nations as opposed to madhabs, although the nations also adopted certain madhabs. It's explicit in Pakistan that you take a modified version of Hanafi law. It's explicit in Saudi Arabia that you take a modified version of Hanbali law. There are nations that are a little harder, like in the Egypt case is a bit complex. But in each one of them, almost the same process happened. You submit first, but in some cases you submit to foreign laws, and then you take a couple of steps back. That's the Egyptian case. In the 19th century, now we don't want these backward laws, let's take the laws from France. By the 1870s, Egypt has too many foreign entities and too many foreign, not in terms of numbers, but in terms of influence. It was about 1%, the foreigners. But which made, in 1874, Nobar Pasha, the prime minister, was trying to convince Khedive Ismail to build courts just for the foreign citizens and the foreign interests as a way to deal with the problem. Of course, also the foreign citizens were too cocky. They wouldn't go to an Egyptian court. But the process was taken in the other direction after the Montreux Agreement, 1937. The same Egyptian legal elites that went to France wanted to go back to Hanafi law and develop its institutions. Something different in Saudi Arabia. It started maybe without the foreign influence in the 19th century, but they came in the 20th century to do the same thing. At the end, there is a degree of hybridity in every national system that we have. And there is hybridity also in the personal law. When we look into issues that are affected by how science, for example, now doesn't look at something called the soul, and we have to shift the discussion, talk about brain functions and so on. So we're affected, right? This hybridity is at the heart of the Sharia today. Again, this is what made somebody like Wael Halak think it's too good for modernity and there's no community anymore and the city is a society of strangers that will never accommodate these old values. Well, it doesn't matter. So what do you call what we have? You don't want to call it the Sharia? There was a time, of course, when it was the other way around, when we heard that modernity was too good for the Sharia. The Sharia was morally backward, organizationally backward. And now we can go, neither direction is helpful. They are now being malleable and they're being reconciled. So one thing about innovation, though, I'll stop now, but I want to say that the Sharia actually adapted considerably through this mechanism of hybridity. At this point, nobody can say that you can't solve certain problems. Of course, you can have solutions that you don't accept, but you can solve all the problems in theory. And the real sticky point is that all our communities are also hybridized. Our communities, some secular Arab intellectuals, hate it when you remind them that their everyday life doesn't look like the average person in their community. And on the other hand, there are people whose religiosity goes beyond the acceptable standards in their community, and they create these isolated kind of utopias, religious utopias or so. So at this point, it's lack of conversation, not the lack of legal tools. And this is, I think, the area where we can wonder whether, you know, what kind of innovative approaches we might have. I have certain ideas, but I think I should stop here.
Thank you very much. This is a helpful point, almost counterintuitive, the idea that the Sharia itself is already, in a way, accommodationist, and therefore, by nature, and its DNA is innovative if one chooses to use it. So this is a good segue to the point that I want to raise to you, Dr. Sohaira. From what Dr. Ahmad is talking about, are we really talking about narrative, or are we talking about doctrine here?
Thank you all for coming to this panel. It's a topic that's not only close to, of course, Ahmad's heart, but of course to all of our hearts who are sitting up here, and then also all of you in the audience. Since I thought I was going first under the premise of ladies first, my remarks were kind of to frame the discussion. So before I get to Malik's question of doctrine versus narrative, I still want to try to frame the discussion. Why are we talking about innovation in Islamic thought, and what does that even mean? Now, the interesting thing for me is that innovation within it has two competing tendencies. If we go back to the Latin root of innovation, which is innovat, it means to renew or change something that's already established. Now, but in the modern sense, when we talk about innovation, we are talking about to create something entirely new. So you have this subtle yet important distinction between whether innovation is about renewing something already established or whether it is about creating something entirely new that has no precedence whatsoever. This important distinction, I think, then follows through in how we see conversations about innovation playing out in the Muslim world today, both in the Arab world and then in the larger Muslim world as well. So if that is innovation, how do we tend to think about innovation? Along which lines do we think about it? So if we look at the panels today, it's from politics, the finance, education, and now we're talking about religion. When we get to the specifics then, there are two ways, again, to think about innovation. Either on the vertical axis, in which case we're focused on institutions, we're focused on state actors. What institutions can we create in the educational sector, in the finance sector, in the religious sector to promote innovation? And then there's the horizontal axis, which is about civil society. It's about individuals, it's about the transformation of community. Now the interesting thing is about until the 1950s, all sociologists who used to talk about innovation were focused on the vertical axis, saying that was the most important thing. But since the 1950s, there's been a huge shift in social scientists' discussions of innovation to say that it's actually the horizontal axis that matters more, it's society. And to that extent, this discussion of religion becomes so important because whether we like it or not, the discussion of religion seeps into all of these other things. When we're talking about finance, we end up with Islamic finance. When we're talking about education, even in the last panel, the question is, what about the Muslim community and education? We can't shy away from the fact that the horizontal axis of the Muslim community is always going to impact our conversation on these horizontal, or on the vertical question of innovation. So now more specifically to Malik's question about narrative or doctrine, what are we talking about? So when we talk about narrative, it's essentially how do we read the past of Islamic history into the actual question that we are dealing with? And when we're talking about doctrine, then we're talking about how do we actually think we solve the problem? What laws, what theology do we use to address these issues? Now, the problem is highly complicated because the answers on this are not uniform at all. Nobody actually, or we don't have a uniform agreement on how or what the narrative of Islamic history is, nor do we have a uniform agreement on what doctrinal changes need to be made in the modern period when it comes to innovation. I taught a class last term in Qatar, and with my students, we were reading a lot of different people who we would think or we would classify as Islamic innovators, and one of the things that I was highlighting in class is that there's actually distinct strands. And these distinct strands come down to this exact question of narrative. How are we reading Islamic history? So one strand looks at the narrative of Islamic history that after the death of the Prophet, things were just bad. The Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he passed away, there was a series of political issues, social issues, religious issues, and the Muslim community never really recuperated from that problem. And so when they're trying to articulate a doctrine of innovation, it's focused on either returning or it's focused on external change, right? It was great in the beginning, and then everything we see through 1400 years has been very problematic. We need to bring something external to then change and potentially return. That's one paradigm. So the narrative and the doctrine come together in that paradigm. Another paradigm is that it is one that looks at the early age as a great age, but also sees another golden age after this, right? And we've heard the narrative of the golden age of Islam a lot, so I won't dwell on that too much. But the idea was that this golden age lasted up until a point, and then things went downhill again. And then you have modernity, which is which is the largest crisis, and once again there's a call for doctrinal change. This time it's external, but this time it tends to be on political lines, that changing the law, changing the doctrine, changing the theology is not enough. We need political change, right? So again, the narrative produces the doctrine is producing the narrative. And the final one, which is something that I think I've inherited from Ahmad and conversation, so perhaps I'm not rejecting him totally yet, is this idea that there was never really a true golden age, right? That Islamic history is cycles of crises that you can identify throughout the 1400 years. And coupled with the crisis is also a reaction, a revival, a renewal, some type of scholarly interpretation and solution to what is happening. So the modern crisis then does not necessarily represent the only crisis in the Muslim world. It might represent a unique crisis in Islamic history, but not the only one. So what the narrative of continuous crisis and continuous response then, what it does on the doctrinal level, it then says that, well, in order to actually find a doctrinal solution, you have to both revive kind of some of the ideas of the past that were used to create solutions to other crises, and also innovate and create new ones, right? Innovate and create new ideas. Bringing both the kind of Latin idea and the modern use of innovation into one, right? So it's not just creating something anew and external, but it's also to some extent going back. So if I want to just kind of conclude my opening remarks, I think what I would say is that when we talk about innovation in Islamic intellectual thought today, it's very varied. Tons of different people will say tons of different things, and this often returns to the fact that people are reading Islamic history, Islamic intellectual history, in a variety of different ways. Where they do agree, though, is that there is a necessity for legal and doctrinal change. Oftentimes, they disagree on exactly what that change is, but some of the main areas which people will agree upon is there needs to be a new conceptualization of politics, we need to deal with bioethical questions, need to deal with questions of gender, and also education, right? The educational institutions and how we actually deliver an Islamic curriculum in the Muslim world becomes important. So that's kind of how I want to frame it, and then we can hopefully open it up for discussion.
Well, I actually, although I feel like I need to pass it very quickly to the Sheikh, but I want to, in 30 seconds, gender, in a redemptive effort, but more curious one. Innovation in that regard.
Yeah, the woman always gets asked about gender. So In 30 seconds, it's quite impossible to answer the question of gender. I can raise where innovation is necessary. So I think innovation is necessary when we talk about the marital contract. This is conversations that Ahmed and I have been having over a few days and something I've been pondering a lot. Innovation potentially required when it comes to questions of inheritance and innovation, I think, also in terms of spaces for women. So our mosques are actually terribly unwelcoming places for women for the most part in the Muslim world. I've lived in many areas in both the subcontinent and also in the Arab world. And I think a huge reason, actually, that we haven't solved the gender question is because we actually haven't properly integrated Muslim women into the spaces in which they most properly belong.
Thank you. Sheikh Mohammed, I just want to mention the efforts of the Sultana here, which has produced something that helped me as a Harvard student transitioning to Al-Azhar, which is the Encyclopedia of Introductory Works on Ibadi Jurisprudence, Mawsu'at al-A'mal al-Tamhidiyya lil-Fiqh al-Ibadi, which I found 16 volumes, exceptionally enlightened. It reestablished at a global level the place of the tradition of Ibadi jurisprudence and its vitality. I also, and the one, I think, one of the other works at the ministry was the very special edition of Ibn Rushd's Bidayat al-Mujtahid, Aviros's, I believe what you have presented and what Oman presented was something that Aviros himself didn't do, which, I mean, it went beyond the four Sunni schools and it included Ja'fari, Twelver Imami, Shi'i Madhab in that comparison. So I wonder if these initiatives allowed for an intellectual dialogue of this refined standard amongst potent schools. What was the motivation behind the reasoned mantiq, al-mantiq al-aqli, that did that, and the motivations? And part of me is thinking that this is the soft power that we've been hearing about earlier. And also, I do believe it's paving the way for other streams and other rivers of madahibs and thought to come together and influence each other to protect the heritage and provide something holistic in the future, and perhaps even subsystems, finance, economics, and so on. I just feel it's almost غير شرعي, illegitimate to just say to those who are calling for, let's dump the madahib to the sea and, you know, do what we need to do, because I don't think it's faithful to mankind's history of the science of epistemology, be it West, East, liberal, conservative, I think our human experiment altogether deserves it. And I do hope sincerely that you would continue with another encyclopedia, hopefully an open source one, including, you know, the many efforts. And we'd like to hear a little bit more about what's in Oman's agenda in terms of conferences, publications, and efforts. I hope we can hear about it, but feel free to share with us your thoughts at this stage.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Malik, and thank you, Sohaira and Ahmed, and thank you very much for the organizers to allow me to attend such important conference, the 11th Annual Harvard Arab World Conference. This conference, one of the rare opportunities to meet such experts who do not come from many different countries, but who have another very important quality. You are interested in politics, religions, arts, and other issues, and you want to do something in order to make this world a better place. And also, I would like to thank you to give me a chance to explain Oman's message of religious tolerance, mutual understanding, and peaceful coexistence. This conference presents an opportunity to spread the message of Oman and its initiatives within a new context. I believe there is nothing better than to spread messages of goodwill to all people. It is my strong belief that peace and stability can only be realized today in any society through dialogue and understanding. And I sincerely believe as well that by working together, we can achieve the goals of acceptance and peaceful coexistence. Going back to the question of Malik about Oman and initiatives and how we live here in Oman, I will take some few minutes to go back to some backgrounds and to explain how it is the situation here in Oman and how we understand the religion here in this land. Historically and religiously, the year 629 was a key date for the Omanis. That was the year that the two kings of Oman, Amt and Jaifar, sons of Julenda, received a letter from the Prophet Muhammad asking them to convert to his new religion. Delegations between the kings and the Prophet were exchanged to study and consider this. Abd and Jaifar became convinced and converted freely, and it followed that Islam was accepted peacefully in Oman. Ever since, because of this, the Omanis have been seeking cooperation with others and avoiding violence based on religious differences. Over the centuries, various ethnic groups, which were under pressure in other regions of the world, found a new home in Oman, where they were accepted and are nowadays also regular citizens of the nation. In Oman, we are based upon principles of religious tolerance and avoiding of conflict and violence. Other religious views or models of interpretations must be respected. Prayers in the mosques throughout the country are conducted side by side with all believers. The communal prayer to God knows no theological dispute. Everyone must answer for himself before God. Today, a large number of followers of various religions are found in Oman, where the state guarantees freedom of religion for the country's nationals and residents. The Ministry of Endowments and Religious Affairs is responsible for the various religious communities in Oman, and the various religious initiatives are provided with the facilities necessary to practice their own faith. Christian churches of various denominations are found, with temples for Hindus, Sikhs, and Buddhists as well. Missionary activities are forbidden to all religious communities, including the Islamic. Oman works to promote a true understanding of Islam, which is a moderate religion, to help counter the bigotry that has led to the spread of stereotypical and erroneous views of Islam and Muslims. In doing so, it seeks to encourage greater intellectual and cultural interaction between people and to highlight the country's practical experience of mutual coexistence and tolerance, and a belief in the need to build bridges of understanding, tolerance, and friendship between people. Reason, justice, and morality. His Excellency Sheikh Abdullah Al-Salimi wrote a book and is published recently about tolerance, a vision. He said and stated, "It is said that the world of the first half and least of the 21st century will be a world of religion. There are some religious believers who judge the 19th and 20th centuries as an age of impulses that were in revolt against religion and morality. But our view of the last century is that the religions too were used to provoke divisions, Professor Hans Kung said that the 90s of the last century, peace in the world depends on peace between the religions, and that there can be no peace between the religions except dialogue between them. Sheikh Abdullah still stated, both we and you share the same concepts because we are human beings. And as Muslims, we are ready and able to welcome mutual recognition. So come, let us work together for the sake of what we have all recognized and accepted, inspired by what is known as fitra and shared experience. There are two terms that occur repeatedly in the Quran, which is the first, al-ma'ruf, what is recognized and accepted as good, and al-munkar, what human beings recognize and accept as to be avoided and resisted. Let us also consider these three qualities: reason, justice, and morality. Man is both a rational creature and a moral creature, and reason and morality must necessarily propose justice and quality. End of quotation. For more clarification about these three elements, reason, justice, and morals, reason is the organ of knowledge and deliberation, wisdom, and universality. Justice is a principle of balance and harmony between the inner motives of the human soul and human universality. Morals are the great religious and human values enhanced by our faith, our humanity, and our responsibility in order to prevail in our interrelations, our specific calling, and our common religious obligations. These are some backgrounds of what we are doing here in Oman and how we do in the Ministry of Religious Affairs in order to bring people in a common sense, in a common ground that will definitely will answer all the questions that can be said and can be asked and need an answer for the better world for all of us. Thank you.
JazakAllah khair. Before I open it up for the group, I'm gonna ask Professor Ahmad a question. Since we're here, we heard a very moving talk this morning about political Islam. Sohaira mentioned revivalism for a moment. So let's crack open the taboo in the sense of the sectarian tension that we're sort of looking at and seeing. And again, I think we all believe that it's predominantly political. But looking at the more recent experiences with revolutions and constitutions that made a difference. The Iranian Revolution, 1979, the 1970 lectures of Al-Khomeini on Wilayati Faqih Hukumati Islami, certainly had inspirations from other revivalist thinking. Khamenei himself translated Sayyid Qutb's Falsafatuna, Shari'ati before that, who took on a Marxist-Leninist view, decided to explain and rid society from its historical Safavid iterations of Sharia and focused on an Alawi one. What do we learn about that? What do we learn about the class tensions and so on, and how was that reflected historically, and what do we see as we look at the future enthusiastically?
Since 2003, we've been trying to answer the question whether the Sunnis and Shiites have been fighting really for 1400 years, or was it the American invasion that did something funny? And then since 2011, you know, things seem to be out of hand. What you mentioned now is the most important thing. The latest Shia revolution is indebted strongly to Sunni thinking. Some of the latest thinking in the Sunni world in the last two or three years is indebted considerably to the more, by then, more advanced Shi'i thinking about political, and about the polity, about the society, about when you seem to take a nap and then wake up, what do you do to readjust and to readjust the speed of law and urf or culture? Because when they move at different speeds or different tempi, they need that adjustment. But war is war. When people don't like each other and they can be motivated to go against each other because of sectarian considerations, this is happening. It's just something you observe also and you acknowledge. There was a war in the 1980s where some Shi'is fought under Saddam Hussein against some of the Shi'is in Iran, and the only distinction was a national distinction. So the split was within the Shi'i house. What I'm saying is everything is possible, but this is not something that we can resolve in the classroom, and we can't either, I mean, we can't even resolve in international arbitration. It's a sad thing, it's a problem, but of course from where I stand, it's more or less the classroom view that you provided, that when I look at the mutual influences, it's very hard to see this as an ideological or a doctrinal difference. It's just a point of, people are too excited, and it's a bad kind of excitement. Political question, more than academic, actually, I think. But I like something that was said in the morning. It's true that some of the distinctions between Sunnis and Shias are very obscure and very much for the academics. And why are lay people, who are not even interested in the subject, so sure that there are that many differences? So to that extent, yeah, the Yusuf bin Alawi, Sheikh Yusuf bin Alawi said, it's true, some of this is really scholarly. And people shouldn't feel that affiliation without being entitled to it. And when people dispute each other based on Mu'tazili and Ash'ari, are you really an Ash'ari? Do you really know what that entails? Have you thought about it? So this is just one of these interesting things, but it is a reality. I mean,
One final question, Sheikh, if I can, before again handing it over. I'm going back because this is getting exciting and interesting. Peace before justice. This vibe that we sense, it's almost not just a peace, let's say, between the Arab or Muslim world or whatever it is with Israel per se, but peace even within the community, between each other. How does that resonate in the coexistence in some of those notions that you just mentioned?
In my point of view, peace is one of the most important elements that people can live together peacefully. And peace started from inside. So if someone feels the peace inside his heart and inside his thoughts, he can live with others in peace. So we have to start to build the peace in the individual's thoughts and in the individual's hearts. For this reason, just to mention, I lived in Germany for almost 8 years, then in UK for almost 2 years, and I recognize that the lack of understanding between people make them lose this peace inside them. They don't feel safe in front of others. So I thought that time in 2009, what we can do? And I talked to my friends in Germany and some other parts of the world, what we can do for the people to bring peace to them in action, not in academic way, or through conferences, or through activities. This is all good. And people can benefit from it, but people need something in action. They need things for their lives, especially young generations. So we started to think in 2009 what we can do. And it jumped in our minds that we can make an exhibition to explain the common ground between people, which is the three elements I said before, which is reason, justice, and morals. So these three elements are very important for everyone, not only for believers or the people who believe in God or not, or believe in one religion or not. So this is a human thing for all people can bring together. So we make this exhibition. We started in Germany with 3 exhibitions, expanded into 10 cities around Europe. Then in 2013, it was a big demand for the exhibition. So we traveled almost in 20 countries in Europe and beyond. Nowadays, the exhibition is almost everywhere in the world, and we visited already 30 countries in more than 100 cities. The reason for this is to bring people together and to try to make peace between people and how they can understand each other. What is our steps to do that? How we can bring peace, not only peace, how we can bring mutual understanding, peaceful coexistence among people. We believe here in Oman, and there is 3 circles which is lead to each other, and they are very important to any kind of mutual understanding and peaceful coexistence. The first circle is knowledge, al-ma'rifa. So we need to know each other. We need to know the knowledge of others, the knowledge of ourselves. I cannot understand someone without knowing him very good, without knowing that religion, how it is. But knowledge itself, it's not enough. So we need to go to the next circle or the next step, which is at-ta'aruf, to know each other. At-ta'aruf is to bring people together, to communicate, to talk to each other, to dialogue, to deliver this knowledge and to share it within ourselves. But knowledge and to know each other, al-ma'rifa, al-ta'aruf, both of them are not enough. We need the third step, which is recognition, al-i'tiraf. To recognize the other's rights of thought, rights of living, rights of everything as human beings. So by doing so, al-ma'rifa, wa-ta'aruf, wa-li'tiraf, we can reach the high level of living together, all of us, as human beings, not only as believers. So to do in peace the same steps or with any other values of the people, we can be in a better world.
It's truly an inspiring narrative, I think, with a microcosm and a macrocosm. It's time to open the questions, and of course, the prerogative goes to the president, Ahmed. Shall I just hand you this?
We'll get a bartender.
Okay.
I'm fairly loud, so I'll just project.
Yes.
Just to set the procedure, my name is Ahmed Al-Jaydi. My question alludes to what Zuhira and Ahmed talked about, which is the question of how Islamic studies are taught today, the pedagogical crisis. And what is being done to come up with this new Islamic narrative? We've seen the transformation in Europe, we've seen it in other traditions, and how do we go from, you know, what can be called in Arabic, hadith mawaghir muqaddas, making sacred that what is not sacred, into encouraging ijtihad, encouraging free thinking in our new approach to Islamic law and Islamic political philosophy?
Ahmed, shall I give you that?
Well, okay. So teaching Islamic thought depends on the environment also, just like law. The latest I have on this is that I owe it to my non-Muslim students, the majority is non-Muslim, and also the children of Muslim students who don't have the same relationship that I have with Muslim culture, to give them a descriptive and a reasonable presentation that looks like what I mentioned when I started. Here's where Islamic law is on the national level, on the personal level, and on the transnational level. But it doesn't stop there for some students, because some students feel entitled to this tradition, mostly either advanced undergraduates or graduate students, and they want to go further. Once they have a relationship with primary sources, I become more like the coach. I can't play the game, but I want to let them know how to play it. And this is really where we arrive at this relationship, because my relationship with Sohaira I actually, the way I articulated it was very external and in a way foreign to the Islamic tradition. I said, I like something Nietzsche said. Nietzsche said, in the name of Zarathustra, whom he kind of made his own sheikh, Zarathustra says, the biggest insult to the teacher is to remain a student forever. I mean, if all you do is tell students to continue to think like you until they're dead, so you, I mean, you may as well just die and give them the opportunity. This is one problem I had when I was educated in Egypt. I loved my teachers, but I can't keep thinking like them. Things change and times change. So the pedagogy will not even be the same in 2025. For now, I mean, so we started maybe 15 years ago, 20 years ago, with the dilemma of can the students begin to deal with primary sources? Because you will learn very quickly if you are dependent on the Orientalists, there are specific questions that will arise in your head. I'm not saying the Orientalists are bad in every respect, but they have their own questions. This I think we did. We have a generation of Islamic studies scholars today who know that. Who know that when you deal with the primary sources, you will find a new world, a different world. And some of them are interested in modern Islamic law, some are not, right? Because again, if you are a Muslim in America, you don't have to worry about what Ziaul-Haq did in 1979 or introduced, what he introduced, the criminal laws that he introduced. These are questions that may be important for some Muslims, but not all. And again, not all the students are Muslim. And a lot of scholars of Islamic studies are going to be non-Muslim. So, sacredness is not going to be there because we're not teaching people morality. Only in private relationships and only with Muslims, we can talk about how we can survive and live by the personal law to the extent that we can. Because a lot of it, of course, differs. You know, Hanafi jurists had the very good sense in the past to realize that law also has a geographic dimension to it. When I live in the United States and I say, no, I'm not going to take mortgages because that's usury, that doesn't work. That doesn't make any sense. You accepted to live by some of these laws. Some of these laws will modify your personal law. But in any case, yeah, that could go on. But definitely teaching Islamic thought, and Islamic legal thinking in general, is still at a descriptive stage, and hopefully maybe within a generation or two we can go farther.
I think one of the important things that Ahmad highlighted in the beginning is this idea of context. So he teaches in California, where the majority of students are not Muslim, and then sprinkled within them are a few Muslim students. I teach at Georgetown, Qatar, which is the opposite scenario. It's the majority of the students are Muslim with a few non-Muslims sprinkled. And so you actually have two different situations, and thus you have two different ways of kind of dealing with Islamic law and how to teach Islamic law in these contexts. I think the first thing that troubled me when I started to teach Islamic law is the lack of ability to access the primary sources by even native Arabic speakers. And I think this was highlighted a bit in the previous panel on education, that knowing modern standard Arabic is very different than knowing classical Arabic. And when students come in and they take an Islamic studies class, I gave them some text and translation, and the first thing they said is, can we get the text in Arabic? And I said, yeah, sure, of course, I'll upload it onto the course website. And I uploaded it, I come to class, and they say, we prefer the translation, all the way across the board, right? So I think one thing that we have to recognize is that Islamic law very much has to be an engagement with the primary sources. To that extent, we have to equip people from a young age with the ability to access these sources and read these texts. The other thing I think, which is a duty of the professor, is oftentimes we try to paint a very clear narrative. Islamic studies professors, especially those of us who are Muslim, end up being somewhere between a professor and a pastor at times. People want to ask their personal questions. They want to know, are they praying right? Who should they marry? How should they talk to their parents about different issues? And so all of a sudden, you're trapped in these two worlds. How do you teach Islamic law, and at the same time, how do you deal with these very personal questions the students are answering or asking? I think for me, it's about giving students tools, and it's about also showing them that there isn't necessarily a clear-cut answer to everything. Now, this itself is controversial, but I think it's important for students who are taking a course in Islamic law to know the variety out there. So they should be exposed to the legal thinking of the Hanafis who allowed alcohol for a while. They should be exposed to Ottoman arguments for allowing prostitution for a while. Even though these things are not norms in Islamic history, it highlights this thing of custom. It highlights how the legal scholars are not simply in the classical world functioning to just give you a legal ruling, but they're there to try to figure out what the custom is, what the individual needs, and how to create the best social setting for religious individuals to live in. So I think it's a combination of giving students the tools before they get into the classroom, and then when they're in the classroom, making them understand that it's not always linear. They need to understand the framework, they need to have the tools, but they also need to know the exceptions, because it's in the exceptions where they realize how the jurists really think and how to potentially think about modern issues in very creative ways.
Thank you.
Sorry, I would like to take three questions now together, if that's okay. So let's start with the gentleman over there, and you're next, and Shaham, I'll take you in the next round, I promise. Or I'll take you in the same round. Your day in court.
Well, thank you very much. I am Yahya Al-Farsi, Assistant Dean of Medicine at Sultan Qaboos University, Oman. Just I wonder about how much the regression of role of women in Islamic jurisprudence and Islamic Sharia has affected the underdevelopment or regression of Islamic narrative and Islamic doctrine. And obviously it affected the innovation. I would like to give a comparison to medicine as a profession. You know, it is up to the year 1540, there were no female doctors. It is only when the King Henry VIII issued a decree when it was allowed for the first woman to be a doctor, a physician. And then by year 1969, only 9% of the practicing physicians were women. By year 1985, only 25% were women. By today, in year 2016, women constitute for 48% of physicians. Having women in the medical profession has improved, has contributed significantly to development of humanities in medicine. It enriched the culture of the profession itself. You know, medicine can be thought of as absolute butchery. Absolute butchery before 1540. So having, with its all bloody pictures, you can imagine. So I think having women well represented in this profession has increased the nobility of this profession. In my humble view, and I can be absolutely wrong, I think regression of having women representation in Islamic jurisprudence and also external foreign policies in Arab world has contributed significantly to all unfortunate negative repercussions that we are thinking about. Just to take 1 minute, I wanted
don't
to.
Have
Okay, I will not take more time.
The questions take the format of a tweet. If you think
sure. That's that is well respected. Okay. I think the point is well taken.
I say this because we represent Twitter, and that's what they tell us. Don't send us emails longer than that. So. The gentleman. Then
thank you, the panel. My question, thanks, Dr. Samira, for your philology of the word innovation. Here, how to draw a line between an innovation in the classical meaning and innovation in today's usage? Because that's, for me, it's the difference between ijtihad and bid'ah. Because today, if we use the word innovation in our terminology used today, clearly means bid'ah in Islamic terminology. So how to draw the line? And do you see any risk going forward, mixing between these two words? Or
I
these
agree
two meanings?
With that. Ahmad is putting me in trouble. I am Saudi, so. Shaham, please.
Following a little bit on that line, in terms of innovation, perhaps one of the harder questions to ask is how do you innovate when you think about how you deal with the other? You spoke earlier, Malik, about freedom and Islam, no Hobbesian dystopia. How do we innovate to say that we have to accept the other, and it has had practical political ramifications in our area when we look at how minorities have been dealt with across the region, particularly in states that have suffered from political events recently in Syria and Iraq. Thanks much.
Thank you to the distinguished panelists, and thank you, Dr. Malik. First, I'd like to salute religious tolerance in Oman. I'm not surprised. The Holy Quran said, you have your religion and I have my own. And I hope other nations emulate this religious duty yet civilized act. My question is directed to panelists from the United States. And that is, what are Muslims in the United States are doing to combat the ugly calls by the likes of Trump and Cruz to discriminate against all Muslims? You're not gonna dwell, you know what they've said, but this is clearly illegal. It's uncivilized in a country such as the United States. And I would like to hear what action, if any, have been taken to really protect the interests of Muslims. Thank you.
Sure, sir. Okay, so I'll try to touch upon the first two questions and maybe a bit of the last one. When it comes to women's representation, are you saying that it's necessary? Yes, women are necessary to be in the jurisprudential fields. I think you're absolutely correct. I think oftentimes the questions that women ask and the way they answer them is going to be different than men, especially in areas that affect women potentially more, marriage, inheritance, mosque participation are some of the ones I highlighted earlier. So I think it's very important. But I think for women to be in those spaces, they first have to be trained to be in those spaces. And I think part of the failure right now is that the institutions that are there to train women to be juristic scholars are not of the same caliber of the institutions that are there to train men. And I've seen this when I lived in Jordan, I saw it when I lived in Syria, I saw it when I lived in Cairo, saw it when I lived in India. You continuously go to these different institutions that are known to kind of be the places to get your Islamic education, and all of a sudden you find that the access to scholars is limited for women. The ability to ask questions, therefore, is limited to women. And I think that's something that we have to address. A personal anecdote, I was in Istanbul and there was a program organized last year to essentially bring together top traditional scholars to just read classical texts with them. There was a group of women and men that were selected, and so I went there for 4 weeks, and you saw that you go there and all of you are selected on the basis of what texts you've read and your proficiency in them and an exam and an oral exam. But then when you get into the room, the women are in the back. The women are limited in terms of asking questions. Some shuyukh went as far as to say that women, don't ask your questions, write them down. So I think, yes, it's important to have women jurists, but I think we also have to understand the road to get there has to be open to women as well. And we have to have the equal access when it comes to education. To the second question of ijtihad versus bid'ah, I think coming, from my perspective, ijtihad is the result of a very clear process of legal thinking. And that's what differentiates it from bid'ah, which is could potentially just be something new that doesn't have a legal, logical, social basis for it. And so I think these two things need to be kept different. So if a legal scholar is giving a new legal ruling, that's not necessarily bid'ah. It's coming out of a clear set of texts, a clear line of thinking, a clear legal principle that they're applying. Versus bid'ah is something people kind of throw around as, you know, people are doing different things in the public sphere that other individuals don't like. So I think that distinction is important. So I'll leave it there, and then Ahmed can maybe clarify more.
On this one? You don't want to say anything about the last one, Islamophobia?
Yeah, Islamophobia, I think it's a difficult time for Muslims in America. They are not necessarily in a position of political strength, but they are getting there. There's, I think, 3 million, is it 3 million Muslims in America now?
That's what the Pew, 3.3 million. They have both citizenship and are Muslim.
But I think the importance of, I think part of it is that there are think tanks definitely there in Washington, D.C., Muslim Public Affairs Council, CARE, ISNA. There's a bunch of others, I can give you a list, that are really talking about these issues. But I think the real important thing for Muslims is to become politically active. The Muslim vote in America is not earned right now by the politicians. Everybody assumes that Muslims are just going to vote Democratic. No, there's no question asked, right? So Republicans don't care about the Muslim vote because they know they're not going to get it. So how they talk about Muslims in the public sphere for them doesn't matter. So if Muslims are politically active, if they get involved in campaigns, if they're senators, if they're representatives, if they're working for congressmen, then all of a sudden Republicans know that this population of 3 million people are potentially voters for us, right? And we have to earn their vote, therefore we have to think about how we engage this population and how we speak to them. Right now Republicans don't even take the Muslim vote seriously, and I think that kind of impacts the way that they speak about Muslims. On the side of Muslims though, there are efforts, they are trying to do things, but of course it's in a limited way because they just don't have the institutional capacity yet.
Okay, so I mean, I don't have to answer all of them because I think your answers are adequate. I definitely think being trapped in words is a big problem. Although, of course, I was trained as a philologist and I like to understand the history of words. But bid'ah also can be a good thing. Umar ibn al-Khattab said about the tarawih arrangement. Na'matul bid'ah hadhi. There was just a very powerful argument about 600 years ago by Shatibi, following some thinking also of by Ibn Taymiyyah, that no, bid'ah has to be reserved for that bad thing, and then the word has a bad reputation. On the issue of accepting others, I mean, if Muslims historically didn't accept others, why do we have too many Christians? And the Spaniards don't have any Muslims by the end of the 15th century. I think there's a new crisis, and we have to understand it, that dislike of others that became excessive in the case of people who are not Muslim or the people who are considered heretics. You know, so it really looks more like medieval Spain in some areas in the Muslim world today. The last question, yeah, it's actually, so there are a few things. These are basic facts for us in the US, but they're not clear here. Islamophobia is cyclical. It's worse in election years. 2008, 2012, 2016 is a different phenomenon compared to the intervening years. That's not consolation. I'm not saying that we have to just wait for the damn election year to end, because there's an underlying dislike that some non-Muslims have against Muslims. And it will come back, and sometimes it's tacit, but it is there. This year, however, because we're living it and we don't know how the future will look back on it, but it seems to be a different kind of year. There is people are taking a lot of risk, I would say, in public speech in the United States. You're right, there is nothing illegal about this, and my understanding of it, the way I'm trying to figure it out, and lawyers know more, of course, is that freedom of expression is now, in American history for the first time, militating against freedom of religion. Now, these are two guarantees that come from the Constitution. In the beginning, in the 18th century, Muslims are not a real problem. So, and even religious minorities that started to get some acceptance, Mormons didn't get a lot of acceptance, Catholics got accepted, and then Jews, and then Muslims. So we feel comfortable with freedom of religion because they accommodate Muslims a lot. But freedom of expression for everybody and for the majority means that they can say a lot of nasty things about Islam, and there's nothing you can say, because the protection of the freedom of expression is absolute. So I think it should be an issue, it should be researched. If I'm wrong in my assumption, I have to look at cases and see whether this is really true. That, but it would be very hard for the American legal system to go back and reject freedom of expression or curtail it. There's a lot of fear there. Expression there includes publishing a picture. Pornography is protected. The concept of obscenity, which still exists in American law, is thinning out. So there is something either very right or very wrong about America that is allowing this phenomena that you are observing. Because it's true, if I am in a country like Saudi Arabia or Oman or Egypt, there are limits to what you can say. The sensibility of both the majority and the minority, there's some semblance of politeness. And in the United States, it seems that a lot of it is gone. So they keep talking about civility and how civility is eroding and all that. But let's wait and see what happens. I'm not happy about it, and I'm not forgiving, by the way. I'm not the kind of, you know, minority member who just wants to accept the status quo. Yeah,
let's wait and see the mass migrations after Trump into Canada. Would you like to remark about Shahan's point about coexistence with other minorities?
I think I highlighted a little bit about the importance of living together and acceptance within our communities. And as I said, it is not only an issue within the believers, because the next crisis will be not within the believers, because the believers of something, there will be a new generation that they are not believing in anything. And this is one of the most problem that will be face all of us as believers in Muslim culture or in Christianity or also Judaism. So our answer for the problem of the future, that we have to be ready for it. The issue of coming together, this will happen, but also how to include others in our communities, that is, we have to be ready for it. The issue of women, I think, if you can give a small example, how we live here in Oman, and in the ministry, 45% of the staff are females. They are preachers, not imams, but preachers and teachers in Quranic schools. In College of Sharia Sciences, which is in Muscat, one of the oldest colleges in Oman, established in late 70s, they have also female education, and more than 50% of the students in this college are females, Omani females. If we come with the coexistence as well and how to be good to others, I would like to remind myself and also if you noticed in the airport, when you come to the airport, there is a sign there, or there is a narrative from the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, about the people of Oman. لَوَأَنَّ أَهْلَ عُمَانَ أَتَيْتْ مَا سَبُّوكْ وَمَا ضَرَبُوكْ. If you visited the people of Oman, they will neither beaten you nor insulted you. So welcome all to the land of peace. We in Oman sailors, we are open to others, we accept others, not nowadays, but thousands and thousands of years ago. If we go back of the history of Oman, we'll see how many people lived here in this country and how many visitors came and go back with good memories. I remind myself with an article written in 1883 by a German visitor, and he wrote an article in 1880s and said that in Muscat at that period, he noticed that 28 languages is spoken in Muscat, which is we can say it is a kind of awlama at that time. So thank you very much. If I say that again, thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you very much for the organizers for this valuable conference, and welcome always in Oman.
Sayyidi, هذا سمتكم ولهذا جئنا يعني. Just in conclusion, I think I do want to say to my dear friend Shaham that in the end of the day, I think we spend too much time focusing on ideas of statehood. Dawla traditionally has meant over many, many centuries the rise of a fortune, of a household. And we forgot the essential element of what it meant to create a community, which is citizenship.
and citizenship was something that brought people together, even in our idealized society. And I do feel that that is based on things that we all discussed in different ways, rights, liberties, freedoms, which we seem to ignore all the time. And with that, I'm just reminded of a point that the president of Beijing University mentioned in a visit. He said, if you contribute a little to humanity, you can change the world, just a little. And here we are, 23% of the world. You know, whenever I go to my home city, Mecca, and we see Al-Hajj and Umrah, you're reminded of that, the magnitude of people who make their way, and you wonder, what's that little? Waleed was telling me yesterday, مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. The one message I sent to Ahmad in the end of the day, I do think it's about تعليم النخب, النخب like Harvard graduates and others. I think that through that, the populace would benefit ultimately. It's not meant to be elitist, but we do need to rethink of the role and the responsibility that comes with it. Thank you so much. Please join me in thanking this wonderful panel. Thank you very much.